Military history has always been different than other kinds of history, because while it shares the essential nature of it, which is that we are awfully curious to know how things developed, how things are the way they are, and that applies to any kind of history, military history has also always been used by practitioners, by serious people who are in the middle of battles, in the middle of wars, thinking about wars, thinking how to avoid wars, and they sort of looked at the historical record to figure out what could have happened in the past, what people believed had happened in the past. They argue about it, and what there is a sort of solid body of evidence. Now, when one undertakes any difficult thing, one tries to get as much evidence as possible. You don't go on a trip without looking for a map, or these days a navigator, of course. And the same thing is with the question of war and peace. There is a sort of history of war that tells you certain things, that you cannot leap and quote lessons of history. That is just a rhetorical device. People get up and say, it's a great lesson of history, this and that. That you cannot do. And certainly, because of the unfortunate workings of the law, I mean Murphy's Law, you cannot go into military history and come up with tricks on how to win battles. But you can come across lots of ways in which you can lose battles. And say, oh, I forgot about that, or let me prepare for that contingency, and so on. Some, you know, fairly straightforward things. I mean, if you read about Byzantine battles in the Near East, you find that the supply of water could be very critical. Anybody who's been to the Middle East and has had to act in some way, I don't mean fight, but just walk or hike or something, knows what it means. It means you need gallons of water, not just pints of water. These are very elementary things. Less elementary things are an awareness of when you have to stop. We all know when to stop if we are being pushed back or defeated, we try to stop the enemy. But when you're advancing, when everything is going away, the momentum, all the feelings to go, then it's only by studying history and its cruel lessons that you might get an inkling of the fact that because you're doing very well, because you're successful, that's the moment to stop before the other side reacts and other people react and things start to go wrong and you run out of energy and run out of things and so on. So there are general, might call big word, philosophical lessons of military history, such as a sense of the culminating point of success, when to stop when you're doing well, and very technical little lessons that will be relevant to practitioners. Now, to those who are not generals or even corporals or private soldiers, the military history studied seriously is, of course, an essential part of the general history. It is absurd, and this happens, for universities to have historical courses. Go down the list, and there's a history of this, a history of that, a history of that, and there's no history of war and peace. This idea, oh, we can't just teach kings and battles or queens and battles. We have to talk about social history, how the poor lived, how the rich lived, sexual history, the history of discrimination, history of slavery. No, the fact is that they all existed in the political context. And the political context was created precisely by those kings and queens and those battles. And it is always war that creates the context, because strategy is stronger than politics. Strategy, it overcomes everything. It is the dominant phenomenon, and that's what we try to recover when we study military history.